Good. Good to see all of you. You know, we've been doing a verse-by-verse study of the book of Galatians. And as we have seen that the book of Galatians is about justification by faith. The first half deals with doctrine, and the second half deals with practical issues. And we're almost done with the book of Galatians. We're at chapter 6 today, and Apostle Paul is dealing with some practical issues for the believers. And the question I want to raise is that the question, should Christians bear one another's burdens? Should Christians bear one another's burdens? And this is the issue that Apostle Paul addresses in Galatians 6, 1 through 5. So I want to go ahead and read these verses for us. Brethren, if a man is overtaken by any trespass or caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness concerning yourself, lest you also be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one examine his own work, and then he will have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. For each one shall bear his own load. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this opportunity to come before you again to seek your wisdom and seek your understanding. Thank you for allowing us to come freely before you. Lord, what a joy it is to know you and to be known by you. Now, as we lift up this message, this word that you have given to us, that the Spirit of God empower this place and change us because we sat under the teaching of your word today. Lord Jesus, so in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. So Paul addresses here the question of somebody falling into sin. He says, if. So he speaks in a hypothetical term because he says if. Now he is addressing believers because he starts off by saying brethren. And anytime you see in the scriptures when the writer of scripture addresses his audience as brethren, he is referring to believers. So brethren, if a man is taken or overtaken, in some translations, I think the better translation would be caught in trespass, caught in sin. So a believer now caught in sin, some kind of sin, then what are the other believers to do, especially the ones who are spiritual? The text says, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. So what is this saying? The saying that somebody who, a believer, who is caught in sin, because, you know, we as believers, even though we're forgiven and we have that position in Christ that we are saved because of Jesus and we're perfect positionally, but there's that sanctification process. Until we go to heaven, we do sin occasionally, and some of us fall a little bit more than others. But we are saved nevertheless. And Paul is addressing those believers, those of us who do sin occasionally, and when somebody catches us in sin, he says, the spiritual ones. Now remember, we just finished tail end of chapter 5, which talks about the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, self-control. And so a Spirit-filled Christian will have the fruit of the Spirit evident in his or her life. And so it would be this kind of individual who should take responsibility to restore a fallen Christian or a Christian who is caught in sin. Paul doesn't specify what particular sin, but any sin is an offense to God, even as believers, as his children. And so Paul is saying, restore such a one in this wet spirit of gentleness, considering yourself lest you also be tempted. What is he saying? He's saying, listen, don't be a high and mighty because you yourself do sin. So you want to make sure that when you can, when you confront someone's sin, that you also do it with the spirit of gentleness, instead of pointing the finger, instead of saying, you shouldn't have done that, you should have done this, because you yourself are susceptible to the same following. And as also 1 Corinthians 10:12, we pretty much know 1 Corinthians 10:13, we're pretty famous, or we're pretty understanding of that. 10:13 says, no temptation has overtaken you, but such is common to man, right? But God is faithful, who will not allow anyone to be tempted beyond what he's able. But before that, see, because before that verse 13, there's a verse 12 which says, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed, lest he fall. What is this verse saying? This verse saying, hey, those of you who think you've got the Christian walk, those of you who think you have everything, you need to be careful. Take heed, lest you fall. Pride comes before destruction, the Bible says. So when we think, we as believers, when we think we got it all together, that's when we trip up. That's what this verse is telling us. And Paul, that was Paul who wrote the 1 Corinthians, and Paul is also saying something similar. Those of us who are spiritual, who are correcting someone, who is restoring someone who has fallen, we need to do it in the spirit of gentleness, because, hey, we can fall just like that individual. So don't be so judgmental is the point. And so from the spiritual perspective, those of us who are not caught in sin but walking with the Lord, we need to admonish with the spirit of gentleness. Those of us who may have fallen into sin and somebody is correcting us, you know, the Bible says, hey, we need to take that correction humbly. Psalms 141 verse 5 says, let the righteous strike me, it shall be a kindness. Let him rebuke me, it shall be as excellent oil. Let my head not refuse it. So those of us who are being corrected because we have sinned and somebody is pointing that sin out to us, hey, we need to accept it. We need to think of it as soothing oil for a wound. Proverbs 17:10 says this, rebuke is more effective for a wise man than 100 blows on a fool. So as believers, we can act as wise, and if somebody is rebuking us, restoring us back into what we need to be, we need to accept it, take that rebuke, because we have made a mistake. We have sinned. Instead of being recalcitrant or stubborn not taking the rebuke. For those of us who don't take that rebuke, it's like we're like a fool who takes 100 blows and says, nope, that's not for me. I didn't sin, or who are you to correct me? And so the Bible is very practical in restoring somebody who has fallen. And so there are two responses to people who have fallen. We can take it gently and humbly, or we can return act viciously and not take that rebuke. But the idea is to restore the individual who has fallen. You know, my wife's got somebody banged up her car, two individuals. One, you know, was at a parking lot somewhere a few months ago, and after church Bible study one day, I saw a dent on the side of the door, and I didn't know who it was. Nobody could put a note or anything. It was there for a while, and then a couple weeks later, somebody banged up her front end, and it was all messed up. But thank God we got the car back after it was restored, after it went into a body shop. Now it looks brand new, just like before. So it's not the best analogy, but you see, when people are fallen or banged up or dented, they do need to get fixed. And so for those of us who are rebuking someone, we do need to do it gently, and we need to restore them. And you know, we have the best model for that. We have the best example, our Lord Jesus Christ, We see in John's Gospel, John chapter 8, verses 1 through 11, he's in the temple and he's teaching, and then we have these scribes and Pharisees come to him, and they bring out an adulteress, and they say, Jesus, or they say, Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The law of Moses says that she needs to be stoned. What is your response? And the Bible says they said that, they brought her and said that to test him. Test him of what? Well, on the one hand, is he going to keep the law of Moses? Is he going to follow that? And then the other hand is, well, he's known to be a compassionate individual, Jesus is, and forgiving. So is he going to follow through on the law of Moses and have people stone this adulterer? Or is he going to give her compassion and forgive her? So that's the dilemma. And so this is what they're waiting to see. The Pharisees and the scribes are seeing how Jesus is going to respond. And so Jesus casually then bends down, picks up a stone, and then he says, you know, he who is without sin, cast the first stone. And then the people, after hearing that, being convicted of their own sins, one by one, they disappear. And so, at the end, only Jesus and this adulterer is left. And Jesus says to her, where are your accusers? Has no one condemned you? And she said, no, my Lord. And he said, neither do I condemn you. Go sin no more. You talk about any individual who had the right to condemn her, it would be Jesus. He was perfect. No sin in his life. But you and I, as believers, even though we have been washed by the blood of Jesus and are forgiven, but we are not perfect here on earth, experientially. Positionally, we are perfect. That's why if we die any moment, we'll go to heaven because of that positional relationship that we have with Jesus. But Jesus did not sin at all and cannot sin. He, being perfect, he's the one who restored her. He was very gentle and compassionate. Yes, he also was true to the law of Moses. He without sin, I mean, he said, yeah, go ahead and stone her if you have no sin in you. And Jesus was the only one qualified to throw the stone at her, but he didn't do it. He forgave her. He was compassionate. He said, go sin no more. That's restoring. And that's what Jesus did for you and me, did he not? And you know, how does that play out in our lives? So you have individuals, you have friends and family members who may wrong you or who may wrong somebody. Then, you know, we see that, we need to be like Jesus and go to that individual or those individuals in a spirit of gentleness, spirit of compassion, and restore them. Why? Because we may someday be in that same position. And so we need to do that. We need to see them face to face. We need to take care of that. This is what Jesus means by bearing one another's burdens. So fulfill the law of Christ. How do we bear one another's burdens? You know, we have burdens, we do sin. And so the context is, yeah, we go in and gently restore those individuals. With the law of Christ, what is the law of Christ? John 13:34-35 says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So what is the new commandment? What is the law of Christ? The law of Christ is this new commandment of love. Love one another. John 13:34-35. And with the motive of love, you see, then we can go to those individuals who are sinning or have sinned, and go in the spirit of gentleness and love. This is the love that God wants us to exemplify day in and day out. This is unconditional love, agape love. And by this kind of love, people would know that we're disciples of Christ. Verse 3, for if anyone thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. So again, he's reminding those who are not sinning at the moment and going to the individuals who are sinning, hey, Paul says, hey, don't think you're something now just because you're not sinning and you're going to correct somebody. But let each one examine his own work, and then he will be rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. Why? For each one shall bear his own load. Now, there are two kinds of burdens here that the scripture is telling us. One, those who have fallen into sin. We need to, those of us who are spiritual, we need to go restore them gently. And then, on the other hand, verse 5 says, each one shall bear his own load. So, you and I as believers, we need to make sure that we do our part to take care of our responsibilities. The more we do that, the less others need to take care of us or rebuke us. Right? And then, in some ways too, application-wise, we can see that in 2 Thessalonians 3, 6 through 15, Paul says this about people who are being idle, people who are not taking care of their own responsibilities. This is in the context of work. You've heard the passage where if any man is not willing to work, don't let him eat. It's not the case that anyone who can't work, it's anyone who's able to work, but don't work. So who volitionally chooses not to work, even though he's able. This is the message. I'm going to read 2 Thessalonians 3, 6 through 15. But we, Paul is talking to his audience, but we command you, brethren, the believers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw from every brother who walks disorderly and not according to the tradition which he received from us. Why? For you yourself know how you ought to follow us. For we were not disorderly among you, nor did we eat anyone's bread free of charge, but worked with labor and toil night and day, that we might not be a burden to any of you. So Apostle Paul and the people that hung around him, they worked to feed themselves, and they were not mooching off of others. Verse 9, not because we do not have authority, even though they have the authority to say, you know, we're apostles, we're your teachers, feed us. He chose not to do that because he didn't want to burden the people he was ministering. But to make ourselves an example of how we should follow, how you should follow us. Verse 10, for even when we were with you, we commanded you this, if anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. For we hear that there are some who walk among you in a disorderly manner, not working at all, but are busybodies. Now those who are such we command and exhort through our Lord Jesus Christ that they work in quietness and eat their own bread. But as for you, brethren, do not grow weary in doing good. And if anyone does not obey our word in this epistle, note the person and do not keep company with him, that he may be ashamed. Yet do not count him as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother. So, Christian responsibility. Paul says, hey, each of you carry your own burden. Each of you carry your own load. Take care of your own responsibility. Those of you who are able to work, you need to work. Don't be idle. And then for those of you who are working and see people who are not working, hey, stay away from them. Let them know that they're doing wrong. Don't consider them as your enemy, but yet admonish them, warn them. This is a practical Christian living. And you know, it's common sense. And you can see that this practical wisdom, if applied, just benefits everybody. Those who warn or admonish the ones who've fallen into sin. Do you think they want to be in that position? No. So if we as individuals do our duty and do our job to walk with the Lord, take care of our responsibilities, then there will be less burden on the ones who take care of us. For example, you know, we see young adults, and many of them are not being responsible for their actions or for their needs. And what happens, you know, somebody carries that burden, and usually it's family and friends, right? So this practical passage of God's Word is, I think, just exciting because it gives clarity to how we ought to behave for those who have fallen. And for those who have fallen, we need to accept it with grace. And also, we as individuals need to be responsible for our own load. You know, but it is amazing. It's great that there are people who are very kind and who do take the time to help us with our burdens. Well, again, when I was in college, in engineering school, I just had physics, calculus, chemistry, computer science, English, all this one semester. It was just very rough. So I know some of you guys are struggling with school right now. And I had some Christian brothers who helped me. Ken, he was a graduate student studying mechanical engineering. And he took his time to help me with physics. Now, there's some concepts and calculations that I just had a hard time mastering. And so it wasn't just one day, it was multiple days. Some days I just went to his apartment and said, Ken, you know, I really don't understand how to do this. And he spent hours. I mean, and I was just marveling at that. I said, you know, here's a guy who's in grad school, and I'm sure he's got tons of work himself, but he is taking the time to help me. So I was just very moved by that, and I still remember that. Of course, when I think of Ken, I think of that. And then another friend of mine, during finals for calculus exam, it's like, I'm like, man, I don't understand some of this stuff. And then a friend of mine, Dave, he and I, we went like a couple weekends just studying just calculus. And all he did was just went over some concepts. I mean, again, I was just marveling at that. I was like, wow, I mean, there's a guy who is just taking his time to help me. So I was just relieved by that. By the grace of God, I passed too, so passed the course. With his help, humanly speaking, with his help. And so those of us who, I know I'm giving an example in the area of school, not sin. There are times when somebody corrected me there too, but the point is, application-wise, you see, this concept, the application is numerous. There's one interpretation. The interpretation is we're restoring somebody who falls into sin. But also, and the point is, we need to carry one another's burden. The question is, should Christians carry other people's burdens? Yes. Am I my brother's keeper? Yes. So we as Christians, that is our duty. That is our responsibility. God has given that to us. So when we have an opportunity to do so, we need to do it out of love and responsibility. And that is Christian love. And you know, the ones who are receiving that help, benefits, and can be restored. So think about one individual today that you can help, that you can restore that person back to where he or she ought to be. You know, the Word of God says, and when it talks about the inspiration, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, says, you know, all Scripture is inspired by God, profitable for teaching, for rebuke, for correction, for training in righteousness, for correction, That correction, that idea has the idea of something that's fallen, that's supposed to be upright, but has fallen. The Word of God restores that fallen thing, or fallen person, back to its original position. And that's what I think of when here, when a brother or sister has fallen into sin, that the rest of us take responsibility with the Word of God to gently bring that person back into its rightful place. So, think about anyone who may be in that position where you can help restore or correct that person. Or maybe you're that individual who need correcting. And if someone is correcting you, accept it. So, with that, let's close in prayer. Father God, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you that your word is everlasting. Your word is all-powerful. Your word is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing as far as soul and spirit, joint and marrow, and able to discern the intentions of the heart. So, Lord, we thank you for your teaching today. Help us to be able to gently, like our Lord Jesus, compassionately correct those who have fallen. And if we are the ones who have fallen, help us to be humble, to be corrected. But also, Lord, help all of us, each of us, carry our own burdens so that others will be less burdened by us. So, Lord Jesus, we thank you for this day. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let us all stand before God.